गुड इवनिंग डियर स्टूडेंट्स, माय सेल्फ डॉक्टर नेहा श्रीवास्तव, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर स्कूल ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर. टुडे आई विल डिलीवर यू अ वीडियो लेक्चर ऑन द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ क्रॉस पॉलिनेटेड क्रॉप एज अ पार्ट टू, विच इज द पोर्शन ऑफ योर यूनिट सेकेंड एंड which will be your lecture number 7, part 2. Before this, means in the earlier lecture, in lecture number 7, I have told you about the cross-pollinated crop, that what are the mechanisms which promote cross-pollination, what are their genetic consequences, their advantages and disadvantages, while I was telling you about the cross-pollinated crop, I have also told you about that cross-pollinated crop needs some medium or some mediator. And in this lecture number 7, I will tell you that what are that agents through which pollen grains are transferred from one plant flower to the other plant flower. So we will discuss that. So these are the outlines on which we will study. Told you about this, all these things, that is what are the agents of cross pollination that are of different types. So these are the names, that is anemophily, hydrophily and entomophily. Other than this, one more is that is orthanophily. So on all of these I will show you some example also. After that, I will tell you about the often cross pollinated species. That what is often cross pollinated, and then differences. So these are the agents of cross pollination, cross pollinated crop. Means for pollination, what are the agents that cross pollinated crop needs, and so what are they? Okay, for pollination, self and cross, you know, it's of two types, that is self and cross. Cross pollination is also known as xenogamy or allogamy. And this xenogamy or allogamy needs some agents. So that may be biotic agent or abiotic agent. Abiotic means they didn't need any organism, any insects to transfer the pollen. They need some means abiotic agents like wind, water. These are the abiotic agents. If it is transferred through wind, that it will be anemophily. If it is crop species are transferred through water, then it will be hydrophily. And some biotic agents are there, so it's the name is changed according to the biotic agent. If it is transferred through beetle, then cantharophily. If through moths, then phalaenophily. If through bees, then melatophily. If through butterflies, then psychophily. If through snails, then malacophily. If through birds, ornithophily. And if through bats, chiroptrophily. If through ants, then myrmecophily. Okay, so and all together, if it is through insects, then we told them, as I told you earlier, that is entomophily. Okay, so these all together called means different types. So it's a biotic agents. Okay, we will not discuss all about every agents, because it's clear that only the because of name only. Because of the agent name only, its name is साइकोफिली और मेलकोफिली बिकॉज ऑफ द एजेंट ऑफ डे. ओके सो नो नीड टू डिस्कस ऑल अबाउट द होल, ओनली वन और टू एग्जाम्पल्स फ्रॉम दिस. सो फर्स्ट इज दैट इज एनिमोफिली. ओके एज नेम मेंशन दैट एनिमोफिली. एनिमोफिली मीन्स व्हेन द पोलन ट्रांसफर इन क्रॉस पॉलिनेटेड क्रॉप्स थ्रू द विंड, और इफ द विंड इज विंड इज द एजेंसी ऑफ ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन ऑफ पोलन, देन इट इज कॉल्ड एज एनिमोफिली. It's written also here that it's a mode of cross-pollination or transfer of pollen grains through the agency of wind. Some examples are there, that is coconut palm, date palm, maize, because the flowers are either on the same plant on different position or in the different plant. So you can see here it is maize plant example. The male flower is here and female is below that. So the how pollen grain will transfer through wind only. It transfers through wind, and because the position are changed, so that's why it needs some agent. Okay, and these are the some characteristics of anemophilic, that are the flowers are colorless, okay, odorless and nectarless. Pollen grains are light. These are some characteristics. The pollen grains are light, small and winged or dusty, dry, smooth, non-sticky. Means these are non-sticky, so that it can transfer through wind easily. Dry form. Stigma is hairy. Yes, you know that the stigma of maize, as I have shown in practical, that it's hairy, feathery or wants to catch the wind. Means it is like that, only that it can catch the pollen through wind. So it is wind-borne pollen grain. Pollen grains are produced in very large number. Yes, if the crop species, if it needs the transfer of pollen through wind, then the number of pollen grains should be large. So these are the characteristics of anemophily. Okay? Now, next is hydrophily. What is hydrophily? Hydrophily means, as name you can identify, that it needs water to transfer the pollen grains. So the agency of the agent will be for transfer of mission of pollen is water. So it's a mode of pollination of or transfer of pollen grains through the agency of water. Okay, as an example is that is Eustera and Vallisneria. You can see that the staminate flower and pistillate flower is in the same in this image, and how it is transferring through water. Okay, because of some characteristics are present in the plant through which is transferred. What are the characteristics of hydrophilic plant? Means flowers are small and inconspicuous. Nectar and odor are absent. Pollen grains are light and unwettable due to presence of mucilage coverage. Means pollen grains are light and unwettable due to presence of mucilage coverage. Stigma is long. The stigma is long, sticky but unwettable. So these are the characteristics because of which pollen are hydrophilic. Okay, and plants are hydrophilic. Some other examples are also there. That is epihydrophilic. Okay, under hydrophilic, it's two types. That is epi and hypo. Epi means if pollination is means above the water. Okay, and it is hypo means below the water. So you can see in this image in epihydrophilic. In epihydrophily, the stigma flower, female flower, female plant, and male female plant. The flowers, you can see that it is female flower and male flower above the water, and in hypo, you can see that it is in the water below the water. So transformation of pollen through water only. Okay. So these are the some examples of hydrophily and types of hydrophily, epi and hypo. Now, entomophily, as I have told that under biotic agents, the above are hydrophily and entomophily were the abiotic agents. Okay, means wind and water. Now, the abiotic agent will be many. I have told you under biotic agents, many are there. Birds, bats, bees, many are there. So, it can come under entomophily. So, the pollen grains which are transferred to mature through the agency of insects like moth, wasps, bee beetles, etc. So, which transfer through this only. So, this is an example, one image in which you can see that the honeybee is transferring the pollen. What are their characteristics? They are showy or bright color so that it can attract the insects. The color should be bright because or so that it can attract the insects. Most insects pollinated flowers have a landing platform. Means the flower should be like that so that the insect should land on that. So it's like that only, that should so that the insects would land on that or sit on that. The pollen grains are spiny, heavy and surrounded by a yellow oily sticky substance called pollen kit. In entomophily flowers, what is like that, the pollen grains, as I have told you that in hydrophily and entomophily the pollen grains are different. But in what is in entomophily, the pollen grains are spiny, heavy. It's heavy and surrounded by yellow, oily, sticky, so that it can sticky substance, so that insect can stick on that and carry the pollen. It's pollen kit. Stigmas are often inserted and sticky. Okay, some flowers provide safe place to insect for laying eggs. That is yucca. Okay. So some flowers are like that, say it provides some space, means safe place for insects to lay eggs. That is called yucca. Okay, some one more example is here. You can see in there the pollen grains, how it is transferring pollen on the bee. Pollen on the bee sticks to a pistil of a flower on the other plant. Okay, here it pollen from stamens sticks on a bee as it visits the flower to collect food. Means it visits the flower to collect food, but the pollen, it's collected the pollen and then transfer it, the honeybee seated on other flower and it pollinated it. So the bee travels to another plant on the same tie, of the same tie. Okay, because of that sticky material only. So these were the example. Another one more I have, just for your knowledge only, one more I have added, that is ornithophily. Means it's the mode of allogamy or cross pollination performed by birds, in which the birds are the agents. That's why it's called ornithophily. Okay, it is a mode of allogamy performed by birds. Only a few types of birds are specialized for this, not all. They usually have small size and long beaks. Due to their long beaks, they can transfer pollen. Okay. So what are the characteristics of the ornithophily birds? Means ornithophily cross-pollinated crop. Means ornithophilous flowers are usually bright colored. The flowers are also bright color so that it can attract birds. The floral parts are commonly leathery, and the ornithophilous flowers secrete abundant watery nectar or have edible parts. Yes, the birds. The ornithophilous flower secretes some watery nectar or have edible parts so that it can attract the birds. And scent is absent. In this, it doesn't need any scent or smell to attract the birds. Only the flower should be bright color and it should have secrete some edible, means watery nectar or edible parts, so that birds can come. So these are the characteristic of ornithophily, and like this I have told you about the agents of the cross-pollinated crop. Then what are the agents? Some examples I have told. This is not the main slide, but you should know. That's why I have given some examples of every agents. Okay, you have learnt about the earlier. I have told you now the cross-pollinated is over and the self-pollination is also over. Other than that, one more is there, that is often cross-pollinated. As I told you that if in the self-pollination, means if the cross-pollination is less than 5%, then it is self-pollinated crop. And if the cross-pollination is from 5% to 30%, or it may go up to the 40 or 50% in some crops, but not more than that. So if it is 5 to 30%, then we will say that it is often cross-pollinated crop, because it is neither in the self-pollinated specific crop nor in the cross-pollinated, because more than 50-60% is cross-pollination is promoted for cross-pollination. It's cross-pollinated species. We will say that it is cross-pollinated. But if it is less than 5%, then negligible, we can neglect it because it is self-pollinated. And if it increases from 5 to 10 to 30 to 40 percentage or 50 percentage, very few species that where it show 50 percent, but it is 30 to 40 percentage. So that crop is known as often cross-pollinated species. Okay, here it is written also that 5% to 30%, and so the example of such species are, that is major crop that you should know, that is jowar, cotton, arhar, safflower, etc. So many are there. So you should know that what is the often cross-pollinated species. Cross-pollinated, which I have told you earlier, self-cross-pollinated, which also you know very well. So the genetic architecture of such crop is intermediate. And what about the genetic architecture? As we know that self-pollination is homozygous, cross-pollinated crops are heterozygous. Then what about often cross-pollinated species? So here it is written that the genetic architecture of often cross-pollinated crop species are intermediate, that is between the self and cross. And consequently, in such species, breeding methods suitable for both of them may be profitably applied. Yes, as I told you earlier, that we need to study the pollination to apply the breeding method, so that we can know that which breeding method we have to apply. So if it is self-pollination, then we can go for self-pollinated breeding methods. Okay, if it is cross-pollinated, then the breeding method will be different. But if it is often cross-pollinated, then the breeding method will be depend upon the profit, or depend upon the breeding objective that what breeder wants. So it can apply both self or cross if it is often cross-pollinated species. The often cross-pollinated species or crop are not more as self or cross, so it's very limited. So we can go for both if it is often cross-pollinated crop. Okay, so these are about the cross-pollinated agents, and in that I have also told you about the often cross-pollinated species. Now references, that from where I have took some images and matter. Before ending this video lecture, I request you to please see these video, everyone, before webinar. If you have seen once, then see once again. This video, lecture number 7 part 2 and lecture number 7 part 1 also, which is as a lecture number 7 only, so that you can ask some questions during the webinar classes. After this, I will deliver you a video lecture on, now pollination is over, now I will deliver you on vegetatively propagated crops, as reproduction is of two types, sexual and asexual. So if sexual reproduction, then the pollination will be either pollination will take place as a self cross, as a cross pollinated or a self or often cross. And now we will go for asexual production. I think you have studied about this area also, but as it is in your syllabus, so I will go for that. Okay, thank you students.